Hey, hey, this is Paula Gloria, and this show is called Farther Down the Rabbit Hole with Paula Gloria. I'm joined by my husband, Joe Barton, on this show, and we have a very special guest for you online, and that's Daniel Vasquez. Welcome, Daniel. Hello? Can you not hear me?
I don't know.
Did we lose Dan?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, great.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. I just want to introduce you to the audience. You were the warden at San Quentin Prison when I had one of the most spectacular experiences of my life teaching transcendental meditation. So thank you for calling in, Dan.
You're welcome, Paula.
Last week, we were expecting your call, and because, you know, there was a little confusion about that, I was able to tell my viewers a little bit of how I got there. But Stuart Moody was teaching in the prisons when he was made a teacher of TM. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi had asked him not to teach people older than, say, college level. And I guess he had been getting such good results, he wanted to teach the older inmates. And he invited me in, and the first people I taught was you and your wife. Do you remember?
Yes, I sure do.
So then after that, I was a little bit nervous, but you were so warm in talking about, well, why don't you tell the viewers from your side, why did you want to embrace this program after you had the experience?
Well, you know what, the prison, San Quentin State Prison, was a maximum custody prison. And it had 1,750 inmates were in the maximum security lockup, commonly called the hole. And half of my population in the general population was serving life without parole possibility. So, you know, I was having a lot of problems with that particular part of the population because of the fact that they were beginning, every once in a while, they would relive the fact of the nightmare that they were serving life in prison. So, Once my wife and I got trained in TM, I figured, well, you know what, let's try it and see if teaching them how to relax will help them settle down and cause less problems among themselves and also against the officers. And so we tried it. I authorized it and tried it. And as far as I'm concerned, it worked. Because the reason we know it worked is that we looked at the disciplinary issues or problems before we started TM, and then after, I think, about 6 months or onto a year, we took another reading of it, and that disciplinary behavior had gone down significantly. And, you know, it was, you know, the population hadn't changed. It had, in fact, grown. More lifers were coming into the prison, but so there was the only factor that was introduced was TM. And so I, you know, kind of give it the credit for helping that population somewhat settle down and
now
cause less problems for themselves and, of course, for the officers. So
right.
I that's my opinion anyway, that right. I think I've seen the change because I studied it.
Right. Well, I remember when I was taking a tour, I looked at all of the photographs of the wardens before you, and they didn't last as long as you did.
I'm sorry, they what?
They didn't have as long a duration there as you did. I don't know what the word is.
Well, there was only one, and that was Warden Clinton Duffy. And I think he was there maybe a year longer than I was.
Oh, because I saw some before you.
There was some immediately before me that didn't last there very long at all.
Now, what do you attribute that to? Because I remember Stuart told me that you had inherited this 18-month lockdown.
I did, yes. I also inherited a special court master that had been assigned, a great gentleman that was a former director of the California Youth Authority, and he was the master. And
what does that mean?
Well, the master is when a judge rules an institution unconstitutional, they often appoint a master, and the master is responsible to the courts to make sure that everything that the judge orders is put into place, and that was the master's job.
Is that kind of like a trustee in bankruptcy?
Sort of like, in a sense, only it's over a prison, not a bankruptcy. Well, the prison was bankrupt. It was bankrupt, and it was falling apart, and it had just it needed a lot of repair and a lot of operational changes.
So how did they...
So it was bankrupt.
How were you qualified for such an enormous task?
Well, I don't know for sure. You know, I mean... I recall that the director of corrections, he's passed away now, but his name was Daniel McCarthy. And he called me one day. I was acting warden at Soledad State Prison down in Monterey County in Central California. He asked me to consider taking over San Quentin, and he said that he just needed me to be there to settle it down, and all I had to do was do 2 years. And that he would, after the 2 years, he said I could take my choice of any prison that I wanted to go to because they were building that number of prisons all over the state. So sure enough, 2 years later, he had one of his assistants call me and ask me, or reminded me that the director had made that promise and wanted to know where I wanted to go. So I told the assistant that to tell the director that I was taking him off the hook, that I wanted to stay at San Quentin. So I stayed there for 8 more years.
Now, the man before you, the warden before you, I don't think he made 2 years.
No, I don't think he did. He might have made 2.5 years or so, maybe 3 years.
Uh-huh.
That he was the one that locked down the prison for 18 months.
So lockdown is, the way it was described to me is that there were gang wars and that it was for the protection of the men that they were doing that?
They weren't so much gang wars. There was racial strife, and it was between the blacks and Hispanics and the Caucasian inmates. So it was every time they tried to unlock it, some violence would occur. So it got easier to just leave it locked down. And of course, the conditions of the prison, both the physical plant and the operational conditions, and it just went downhill. The prison was dirty, and it was not being cleaned up, and nothing was being repaired. And when the judge walked in to tour the facility or to tour San Quentin, it was the 14th month of the 18-month lockdown, and she was pretty appalled at what she'd seen, and she appropriately declared it unconstitutional.
Wow.
And the courtmaster, Alan Breed, was appointed the master.
And had you had a relationship with him before you came to San Quentin to be the warden for 2 years?
No, I did not. You know, what I did is I got, of course, the orders from the judge as to what had to be changed. And then also, Mr. Breed had written an article called Article 56. It was a federal report. Actually, it was the How to Be a Courtmaster. That's what I called it. And I made that and the judge's order mandatory. The judge's orders mandatory reading for all my management team from lieutenants above. And they were required to read it and understand it. And my expectation was that we were going to get along with the master and not argue or fight with him, because, you know, the only thing we could do was it was going to be, going uphill. It had already reached rock bottom as far as I was concerned, so there was nowhere to go but up. Those were my expectations of staff, that they respected the master and learned what his job was and how he was going to do his job, and also the declaration of the judge, Beverly Sabbath, to declare the institution cruel and unusual punishment.
Wow. You told me at the time that the prisons were like the dark underbelly of society. Do you remember telling me that? Or?
Yes, and they are. They still are. They're the ugly side of our society. That's where all the rapists and murderers and robbers and child molesters and all manner of people go there to,
now,
provide a safety net for the rest of the citizens of the state that that's incarcerating them.
And yet you had so much compassion for the men, because at that time that was kind of the height of the Christian backlash, and we teachers were accused of all kinds of things, and there was a lot of maligning going on in the public, and I was fearful that you would be depicted as the guru warden. And I remember you saying, no, I know this is a good thing.
I think in Marin County was always a little bit of a liberal county, and I think that TM was already somewhat known to at least the general public of Marin County, where the prison was located. I don't think it was that much of a surprise, Paula, but that's my opinion anyway.
Well, yeah, but I know that the location of San Quentin Prison is in Marin County, which is a very upscale and very wealthy county. I mean, it's probably the most valuable real estate on the bay. And probably were efforts to probably relocate the prison, right?
Well, there's always been talk about, we should close it down and give it to the real estate developers and let them, knock down the prison and build condos and so on and so forth. But that prison has been in operation since 1852 to the present without any day off whatsoever.
Right.
Since 1852.
But it still seems...
So it hasn't closed up yet, and I don't think it's going to close up, not in my lifetime anyway.
Well, but that's what I mean, because I went back and forth, across the Richmond Bridge all my life, but you never go into the prison. So when I finally went in, I don't know why it was. Did you pre-select the people that I was teaching? Because these men were so nice to me. I felt so safe. I felt very respected. I remember at one of the parties, because it was fashionable, TM in the prisons, they had some Hollywood stars coming up and around the punch bowl. I think it was Superman himself who was sheet white. But for me, I felt like I was doing something important. And I felt that some of these men realized that, the whole purpose of meditation to achieve enlightenment was a precious opportunity, and that even though they were in prison, they were making the most of this opportunity, and therefore when I was coming back to do follow-ups, I was more and more respected, and I felt more and more protected, that I was kind of like in the in crowd.
Yeah. Well, you know what? You were helping them. That's why they respected you, and you didn't show any fear. And you were helping them. And you know what? I didn't pre-select any of the inmates. You went into that prison, and you what you found was what you got.
Well, I started.
They were all lifers. They were all serving life prison sentences.
Were they all?
So there was nobody pre-selected. What you walked into is what you walked into.
But Stuart first took me to the ranch. He said that was for the light cocaine bus. So do you remember that section called the ranch? That's what I remember.
Yeah, of course. It was a minimum custody.
But were they lifers?
No, they weren't lifers there. Those were minimum custody inmates that were, like trustees, did the work on the property, did the work outside the property or outside the walls, and maintained the residences. And did maintenance work escorted in the company of maintenance personnel at the prison.
Well, now later on, then I went to, I don't know, I guess you don't call it hardcore, but there was a little trepidation at first because I would have to go into a private room with a man to give him, his mantra for the short ceremony. But again, there were guards right outside, so, if there was any problem, I could call. But my goodness, there wasn't any problem. It was the most sublime experience. And by the time the men were sitting in for group meditation, Stuart told me that there were some men who, prior to having this deep relaxation, said, "Are you kidding me? I'm not going to close my eyes sitting next to him." And yet you would have an assortment of men who otherwise might not have sat together, having these really profound vibrations coming out. They were it was one of the highest experiences of my life to go into San Quentin prison. It sounds so strange to say that the most spiritual experience that I had happened in, like you said, the dark underbelly of that society doesn't want to look at.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
That's
a good way of describing it, and it still is. It still takes the worst of our citizens out of the streets and out of our communities, and incarcerates them. So that's how the public is protected. You know, it's not the best system in the world, but it certainly is. It is more humane in the United States and in especially the state of California, but it's nevertheless it's big business. You know, it's big. There was once a President Eisenhower called the military industrial complex.
I see.
Well, in my opinion, corrections in California is a correctional industrial complex. It's a multi-billion dollar a year cost operation that comes straight out of the state budget. It's not self-sustaining. It cost us as taxpayers approximately $6 to $7 billion a year.
What do you think, Dan, would be a better system when you said ours isn't ideal? Because I think that's what we're all striving to understand.
Well, you know what, I was always a strong believer that, preparing a person for release, for eventual release, excuse me, and approximately 84% will eventually be released from prison. And it's always been my philosophy and my belief that pre-release, you know, preparing a person for eventual release, when it is called a process of pre-release. And that process in the department, as far as I recall, and I don't think the policy has changed, it was voluntary the last 21 days of your sentence, which I always thought was, pretty ridiculous, you know? Because in my opinion, I think preparing a person for eventual release from prison should happen, within a month after the person is incarcerated. And it should continue on an ongoing basis until just before his release, not 21 days before. That's nuts. That's ridiculous. It should start right away, and it should be ongoing, and it should be they should be tested as well in terms of learning how to read and write, and getting their driver's license straightened out, getting all their warrants straightened out, and finding a place to call a residence or go to a program that will help them reintegrate back to society, find a location that will accept them, a place that will accept them, and also employment prospects. And, you know, it takes time. And so, you don't start it 21 days before you're released. You start it probably about no more than 3 months after you are received in prison, in my opinion. But nobody's ever done that, and I don't know why. I think it's because the philosophy is punishment and not rehabilitation.
I see. So if that was your personal belief, then I can see how you would lean towards programs, especially if they were made available to you. The TM organization made this available to the prison system gratis, right?
Yes, you did, absolutely. It didn't cost a dime.
Right. Now, I grew frustrated about that because I had a boyfriend at the time, and I could see that Stuart Moody had a woman that was interested in him, but she was also interested in a man who could be a provider. And I could see how good he was at it and how much he believed in it. And I would have to pay $5 an hour for somebody to cover my wicker furniture store when I went out to teach. And I loved teaching. But I could also see that I had to pay my rent, and nobody could sell as well as I could when I was gone. So I came to this monumental sort of landmark in my life where I decided I was worth $40 an hour. And I said, I'm going to talk to the warden and tell him I want $40 an hour, because I had these recidivism studies showing that the men weren't returning and that that was saving the state, you know, millions of dollars. So I thought at least I could, you know, squeak in a professional rate. And you were very kind about it. And you said there simply wasn't any kind of funding that would be available for it. And it put me into such a state of shock. I said, you know what? I felt like Helen Keller, you know, she couldn't communicate and she had to learn how to write in the palm because she was deaf and blind. And I said, somehow this is so good and I should be able to be supported doing this, and so should Stuart. Stuart needs a girlfriend too, you know.
Well, and Stuart used to live in his car for a while, you know. He was so broke.
But I know. I know.
The department at that time just, and still is, not that enlightened about these types of programs. They, you know, I don't think anybody that I know of believes in it. Maybe they're afraid that they'll be criticized. I don't know, but you know, I think it's ridiculous that they don't embrace more of these programs to help people understand, how to relax and how to get in touch with their more spiritual side and trust themselves among other inmates, which is not easy to do. As that person told you, I'm not going to go into this group and close my eyes with all these other guys.
Right. Right,
you know,
right.
It's just something that they don't do. You know, it's a bad, tough environment. You know,
people kept
an
saying
environment where people die.
Right,
you know, both staff and inmates, unfortunately, and you know that's the type of environment that prisons.
Well, that's
are
what
about.
That's what I'm saying. That's to put me in such a shock, because I thought, here you have such darkness, and then the brightness is so strong. How could it be mere money that's preventing this exchange of knowledge? So I said, clearly, I don't know the language of this society. It must be money, and I'm going to learn that language. And I put that in my mind, and I eventually made $5 million in cellular telephone licenses. Of course, now I'm working out the karma for that, because I can see what these Wi-Fi signals and so on are doing. But still, it was an important time in my life, and I had to say, if I go in there and if I keep teaching for free, it's not showing these men that I have enough self-esteem to know what I'm worth. So with great sorrow, I had to say goodbye to you and to the program, and Stuart was unhappy about that, because believe it or not, none of the men male TM teachers wanted to go into San Quentin prison. So for some reason, I had this affinity. I think Stuart picked me because I was traveling around the state of Oklahoma, and I was sponsored by a colonel in the Army at Fort Sill, Oklahoma, in Lawton. And he'd been to Vietnam 3 times, and he said there just had to be a better way. He told me that some of the privates were throwing hand grenades into their officers' tents, that it was that bad. Joe, my husband was in Vietnam. So you verify that, Joe?
Yeah, that was happening over there. You know, a lot of times officers kept putting men in danger, and you know, when they keep putting you in danger, it was called fragging. Somebody would roll a grenade into an officer's tent, and
that
happens quite a bit over there. People here never heard about it, but people in Vietnam knew what was going on.
Yeah. Every once in a while you would hear about that, and I guess there was a lot of inexperienced young lieutenants that were in charge of platoons or companies, and, you know, they just blindly followed orders, and, of course, the grunts, the foot soldier, he's the one that's up front. So, and he's going to get wounded or killed. So, they were blaming their officers, obviously, and that happened. So,
were you in the military, Dan?
I was. I was in the military for 3 years.
And what was that like for you?
Oh, it was a great experience because I left when I was 17 years old because I was getting into a lot of trouble in my community, you know, and I had a probation officer who kept talking to me about making better decisions, and I decided to really change my life, so I convinced my mother and father to sign for me, and I went into the service. I went into the Army. And, you know, the Army is, you know, if you're a brain surgeon, they'll make you a cook. And if you're a cook, they'll make you a brain surgeon. You know, with me, I was, you know, always in trouble, and they made me a military policeman. And so it was kind of like the proverbial fox guarding the chicken coop, you know. But I learned a lot about policing from the young men who were draftees that were police officers from all over the nation. They were my teachers. So I learned a few bad things, but I learned mostly good things.
That's interesting.
And so when I got out, that's when I started working in corrections.
You know, Joe entered the Army at 17, or the Navy. Navy at 17 years old also.
I was in for 4 years. I was on a ship.
I did three. And then I got out and tried to catch up with all those teenage years, and that didn't work. So I finally settled down and got married and started pursuing the corrections career. I did 30 years and additional years in other correctional experiences. So I've got over 36 years, and I've been consulting since 1986 to the present. I have consulting cases all over the nation.
I'm
still very involved.
I also remember you saying something, and I don't want it to be misunderstood by all the listeners. You said that if the prison walls were to go down tomorrow, some great percentage, I can't remember what you said, of the men would just stay there. Do you remember saying that? And
yeah, well, you know what, they don't know where to go. You know, they have nowhere to go, and they know that if they hit those streets again prematurely, that they're going to they're going to make mistakes again. You know, they're going to commit crimes, and you know that it's not going to be good for them. You know, so you know they know that. You know, and of course a lot of them would have walked out. You know, but because the department never invested any real time and effort to do any pre-release training of individuals, so they would go out worse than they came in. They would learn, but they would learn the life of crime from the other prisoners. There was nothing else being taught. And when overcrowding began, there was men having to sleep in the classrooms because the prisons were so overcrowded. So it got worse.
Do you think that some of the reason that they didn't want transcendental meditation in the prisons, or I would imagine other programs I've heard of, the Course of Miracles, if it's actually on the books as something to rehabilitate, it seems as though there's an industry not to rehabilitate. There's an industry where it's looking like filling hotel rooms, you know.
Yeah.
I
understand what you're saying. I would hope that's not the case, but you know, even I get a little skeptical because I've seen this business has really not changed at all in the 36 years that I worked there. And in the consulting that I do and the prisons that I tour and go and see and look at the issues that are occurring, it's the same. So maybe it is protecting the correctional industrial complex. I don't know, because nobody's making any change. It's just business as usual.
What do you think about all these commercial prisons, these privatized that corporate prisons?
Well, you know what? They exist. In fact, I worked for one for a while. I worked for one of the largest in the nation. I don't want to mention its name, but it was a pretty big system, and I was expecting that it was going to be really positive because the bottom line was profit, you know, but it had more bureaucracy than it did at the state or county levels where I worked. And wardens were all wardens that were drawing pretty good salaries and also stock options, you know. So some of them were making, you know, pretty good bucks, you know. Like for me, when I started, they had stopped the stock options. So it's just my luck, you know. If it wasn't for bad luck, I wouldn't have any luck at all sometimes.
Yeah, but what about the karma, Dan?
Excuse me?
The karma. You have to consider the karma. You know, when I made $5 million with cellular telephone licenses, it seemed like that would be great. You know, now I have all these millions of dollars, and I don't have to worry about covering my store. But then I realized it's more than just money. And in a way, money's never enough. It needs more people that care about each other. And just your comment to me, I don't care if they call me the guru warden. I know this is good for the men. You stuck your neck out.
Yeah, I did, and I believed in it. You know, I wanted to learn it first, you know, because I didn't know anything about it. As far as I knew, it was like trying to fly magic carpets or something, you know. but when you sat with me and my wife Juanita and taught us, you know, I still practice it when I'm under some stress, or you know, I'm going to testify in a heavy case or represent somebody that's really serving a lot of time, and I'm feeling a little nervous. I practice TM for a while and relax,
right.
And I know it helps me because I go in there and I really kick some butt, you know. So, so it helps me, you know, and I still practice it occasionally, not as often as I know I should, but it's like when you need it, you know, it's there.
Right, but at the same time, we don't. You know, I went through different phases in my spiritual development, and I ran across one teacher who said, "The magic of the mantra takes a lifetime to understand, and chances are you won't. So don't." And what he was saying is that it can become hypnotic, and you don't want. Obviously, you can't hypnotize your way to enlightenment. So I embrace some. Other practices, you know, one teacher said meditation isn't something you do twice a day. It's something moment by moment, you know, with your eyes open. And mm-hmm. I would say that by the time I met my husband or saw him in court with his son, it that was another spectacular spiritual experience, that just on the level of law. Again, Jesus saying he didn't come to change a letter of the law, but to fulfill it. When you see real law in place, it's magnificent. And real law says that for a crime to exist, you have to have a harmed party. And a lot of people are in prison for the so-called crime of poverty, which really isn't a crime.
Exactly. And I had a friend once tell me that if you had an appreciation for hot dogs and the law, he advised me never to go see either one of them made. So I never forgot his advice, you know.
Right.
Don't go see hot dogs made, and don't go see the law made.
So, right. But there seems to be a voice and a spirit that's rising, because now the incarceration seems to be the last step to covering up bank fraud. Like, in other words, when I went into San Quentin prison, I was astonished that these weren't scary people. They were kind of like losers. And yet I had been around scary people. I remember once, because sometimes I could get myself into a very sensitive state, a limousine pulled up and somebody opened it up and got out. And it was like a blast out of hell. Some bad vibes came out. A person with a briefcase can harm society more than some guy maybe stealing a hamburger. You see what I mean?
I mean, look at the arms dealers and how much money, ammunition dealers, and how much money they made in the conflict of Vietnam and World War II and the Korean War, and they're still making it with the conflicts in various parts of our globe. You know, so somebody's making those bullets and guns, and somebody's making some money. It's not the poor GI on his boots on the ground. It's somebody pretty big in that limousine with the briefcase.
Right, right. So when you kind of let your hair hang down with peers, of your own, what do you discuss in terms of solution? Because you couldn't be the only sensitive person in this field.
Well, you know what? Nobody's interested. Nobody's asking me, hey, Dan, what's your opinion? You know, what do you think we ought to do? Nobody asks. And I don't think nobody really cares to find a solution. And I think that a lot of the solution is just preparing people to be released back to prison if it takes 5 years or 4 years or longer, that they should study and study and study and get proficient as much as humanly possible to return back to society as productive citizens. But nobody asks me. Nobody asks me my opinion.
Well, we're asking you now on behalf of thousands of people.
Millions.
Yeah, back. One time I was on an airplane and I happened to be seated near Governor Brown, and he asked me some questions, and he asked me some policy questions about policy change, and we discussed it, and he implemented them. You know, I'm sure that I'm not the one that caused the implementation, but he ran them by me, and one of them was the realignment of the prisoners doing time in the state of California, and also parolees being supervised by county probation officers. So he implemented that, you know, but he had the courage to ask somebody, and he knew that I was a warden, a former warden, because I introduced myself. Quentin reminded him that he appointed me to several positions. You know,
so there you go, Dan. Somebody did ask you, and
somebody did ask, but I think he already knew what he wanted to do. But he ran it by me anyway, which made me, feel pretty good.
Well, you've given me a lot to think about here, because I think if we create a table. And the purpose of the table is to invite people to come together to think on these problems. I can't see how anything wrong could come from that.
No, I don't think it can either. I think everything good will happen out of that, you know. But it's just that, you know, nobody's willing to take that position. Nobody's willing to stick their neck out.
And say,
let's talk. Let's solve this problem. What can we do?
Right, because it's not just when you say a man is incarcerated, you should start to think about his release right from the beginning of his sentence.
Right from the beginning, and preparing for that eventual release.
And so should society be preparing to accept him back.
That's true. There should be, there should be some awareness. You're right. I think that's a very important issue, too, is to educate the community and let them know that the individual is preparing for release, not just, lifting weights and watching television and doing bad things, but that the person is trying to be as productive as possible to return back to our society,
right,
where they live too, where we live. And I think that would go a long way in getting helping with the fear that people have of offenders living next door to them. You know, like in my neighborhood, we have a sex offender that lives down the streets. But you know what? I didn't even know it. I don't check the Megan's Law website that we have to see who's doing time where. I'm not interested in that. You know, and he waves at me all the time, and I think he's a pretty nice guy. You know, and he paid for his crime, but he lives down the street. I wouldn't have known it except that a neighbor told me about it.
Right, right.
So, but I don't go around finding out who's doing what time for what.
Dan, would you want to take any questions from the audience if anybody wants to call in?
If there's any questions, I'd be more than happy to try to answer.
If anybody wants to ask Dan Vasquez, who is a past warden of San Quentin Prison, any questions, this is a great opportunity. He's calling us from California right now.
That's correct.
Yeah. And our number is 679-9104. That's Woodstock 104, 679-9104. People might be a little shy, Dan, but I just thought, you know, it's a good opportunity for people to share with somebody who's a professional in this field.
We'll see how interested they are. Might be indicative of what's happening in our society, that a lot of people just don't care. You know?
Well, I don't know if it's not care. I think people are a little bit overwhelmed, and particularly a topic like incarceration, because that's the one growing industry, that and so-called health care.
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. Both costing tons of money.
Right, and the results, like even you're having to say, despite your compassion and wanting these good programs for the men, and even being psychologically inclined that you should be aiming towards the release right at the beginning, still there's a little sleepiness. Again, I feel it's because of the Wall Street speculators.
Yeah, it's something, you know, even the private people are making money with prisoners, so one time the unions and the corrections were definitely against any privatization coming in to help with prisoners, but you know that changed with the overcrowding, and that the union lost some of its power too, you know, some of its control. But it happened.
Have you or peers like you looked into what the financial motivation is to keep a prisoner in prison? Let me just give a little aside. An oncology nurse said that while she was carrying out the orders of the doctor, she never had any idea that a regime of an oncology treatment, unlike all other treatments, gave kickbacks to the doctors. And so a lot of the men that you may be incarcerated, there was a hidden side of the economy that was...
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's a billion-dollar industry, and most of it is in salaries and wages. You know, 70% salaries and wages. So, you know, I mean, there's a lot of individual and special interest groups to keep those dollars rolling. A prison guard or a correctional officer makes more money than our teachers.
Wow.
And all they need to begin to work is to be 21 years of age and have at least a GED high school certificate. Where a teacher has to go to school for 4 or 6 years, you know, and if they want to be an administrator, they go out for another 4 to 6 years. You know, but to be working with prisoners, you just need a GED and be 21 years of age and not have any felonies on your record.
I got a question. What can be done to feed prisoners to good? I happen to have been incarcerated, and the food in prisons is the worst food I've ever tasted.
Really?
It's disgusting, the food in prisons. When the guards are getting so much money, like you said, there's a lot of money in bureaucracy. It seems like the prisoners and anything that would help the prisoners or food or the conditions even in prison suffer because of all the people skimming off the top.
Well, I'm not sure about that, but you know what, where I worked at, the food was, there wasn't really nothing to write home about, but it was it was good. It was okay, because we used to, officers had to sample the meals as well, too, you know, and write a commentary on all the items that were served. And, you know, one of my cook, you know, my head cook in San Quentin was a Filipino-American who, you know, in the Navy, I don't know if you recall, you know, anybody that was a Filipino or mostly African Americans, they worked in the galleys, or the Filipinos used to work as cabin boys for the ship's captain.
Right.
And his name is Lou Umbe, and Lou Umbe was one of the best chefs I ever came across. He learned to cook on an aircraft carrier with about 5,000 men. And in the kitchens, I think he told me one time they had five or six kitchens or seven kitchens that ran 24/7 to accommodate all the workers, and that everybody had to do something with keeping that ship afloat and keeping it, strike ready in case of some action somewhere that the pilots had to go to. So, you know what? He used to put on a good meal, and that was the expectations of his cooks. And then he used to save me money that he would get me out of the hole whenever it was time for the budget review process. He'd always save my neck, you know. So I thought, I loved that guy. I thought he was the greatest things that, since sliced bread, you know. Well, and I really respected him, and I still do.
As a warden, you may say that, but I'm sure most of the prisoners would have had a different opinion about the food.
When I was in,
the food is adequate. The food was disgusting. And I've been in more than one, I was only in one prison, but I've been in quite a few jails over the years. And I do have to say, the food was disgusting in every one of them.
Well, you wouldn't know about jails, Dan, right?
I operated a county jail, the fourth largest in the state of California, for 4 years. So I'm aware of jail operations as well at the county level. And a lot of my work takes me into county jails and issues that swirl around the county jail operations and conditions of confinement. So, I frequent the jails, not just as the administrator of one, but because of my consulting work. So, but I don't go in there to eat meals, you know, and I'm sure, you know what, like the Army meals, you know what, I found it okay. I remember one time I was going through the chow hall, and I was in the state of Georgia, and the cook, you know, he slapped some stuff on my tray. It looked like oatmeal out of the bowl, you know. And I looked at it, and I'm thinking out loud. I said, "What is that?" And the cook told me, he said, "Boy," he says, "that's Georgia ice cream," and it was grits. He told me it was Georgia ice cream, you know. And if you roll a bunch of eggs in it and put some Tabasco sauce, it's okay, it's passable.
Say, another thing along the line of food, I was doing a lot of research on health, and I looked at vitamin D studies coming out of the University of California at San Diego. There are a couple of scientists there for over a period of 30 years showing that simply having sunlight is very important to the health, that we're more like plants than we realize. And, you know, if you take a plant and you put a bandage on it, and after a number of days, the part that if you unbandage it, you'll see it's a very kind of a not as healthy a green as the rest of the plant.
Yeah. And, well, there's a lot of prisoners in California that are deprived of outside exercise. They don't see anything but filtered sunlight.
That's
what
that's
a pretty harsh harsh treatment of people.
Well, that's what I was thinking, that the vitamin D studies have been suppressed everywhere. And I thought, if those studies came out, just because you were talking, Joe was out for a smoke when you were talking about that San Quentin had been ruled on unconstitutional, a cruel and unusual punishment, that if the vitamin D studies were really released and accepted, you know, breast cancer would be virtually eliminated. Of course, we don't live in a society where women can expose their breasts, but it's nice to know that in your private time, you could, you know, preemptively, you know, protect yourself. But I thought, because of my experience at San Quentin, oh my goodness, if these studies were accepted, you'd have to redesign the prisons, wouldn't you?
Yeah, some of them would, especially places like Pelican Bay, where a person in lockup is, you know, housed, you know, has no direct sunlight, nor fresh air.
Right.
All filtered.
Right. And yeah, a lot of...
It's very harsh treatment of some individuals.
Right.
Of course, many of them are dangerous, so, you know, I guess, you know, that's the perceived way of handling these individuals is isolation.
Right. But then, you know, maybe people wouldn't be as dangerous if they were more balanced, if you look on it, and, you know, from a health point of view. Oftentimes they say, oh, antibiotics are so great and we've eliminated disease. But it turns out when you look at what the conditions were like in some of these places that they're citing, little children were in, you know, working in these enslaved conditions, and they didn't see sunlight, and that's why the disease was so great.
Yeah.
And you
yeah.
could imagine that it would also go, you know, mentally.
Mm-hmm. That's correct. Yeah. Well, in some prisons, they're pretty harsh, you know. They have some pretty dangerous individuals. It's just the way they do business, I guess. You know, nobody's willing to change it. You know, so. And well, nobody's asking opinions of former wardens, at least not this one.
Well, you know, let's see. It's really been wonderful to have you call in. Do you have any final thoughts that you'd like to leave with people?
Well, yeah, I think so, Paul. I think that people should find out more about the business of incarceration. What is happening in your state? How are the prisoners being housed? How are they being treated? Are they learning how to return back to our communities as productive citizens, or are they just being warehoused? Find out. And if, you know, well, the more you find out, the more people that do, maybe those people can make some changes. You know, and insist that the legislators get up off their caucuses and go and find out what's going on, you know? There's a lot of things happening all over the prison system. Systems in our nation, and you know, the more people that become familiar and educated about the prisons, maybe they can start then making changes.
Well, it's in the Bible.
At ground level,
it's in the Bible to go into the prisons to visit the prisoners.
That's right. So, it does say that.
Right. Well, thank you, Dan, for calling
You're
in.
You're welcome, Paul. It was great talking to
yeah,
you.
Yeah, and give my best to Juanita.
I will.
Okay.
I
will. Bye-bye.
Okay, good night.
Good night. So, any thoughts before we wrap up this episode of Farther Down the Rabbit Hole?
I think the incarceration rate in this country is outrageous, you know. When there's no victim, there's no crime. I basically let you talk with him, but... you know, I've been there, and I've seen the abuse, and I've seen guards, you know, are not. I watched two inmates in front. I was locked in at the time, and I watched two inmates. One inmate came out and happened to have a razor, and he sliced one, and then across the chest, and the blood was running down. Then that inmate went back to his cell and got his razor, and they stood there slicing each other, and I could see the guards by the gate, and I said to the guard, are you going to stop this? You know? and they just kept slashing each other. And I said, are you going to put a stop to this? And he said, well, when they pass out, I'll call the medics, you know. I think that, you know, when the guards treat prisoners that way, it makes prisoners worse. You know, that guard should have stepped in and right away said, both of you go back to your cells. Maybe they would have answered. Maybe they would have done it. Maybe they wouldn't have, you know. But, you know,
You're saying there's a psychological profile for cruelty, to choose guards for cruelty? Because those would be cruel guards.
I don't know so much that there's a psychological profile to choose them to be cruel, but they're definitely not not really concerned about the inmates. If inmates are killing each other, you know, the guards won't try to stop it. They wait till, prisons are brutal places, you know.
Yeah, and I don't think Dan would deny that, though.
And unfortunately, we're putting a lot of young kids in with real hardened criminals, you know. I mean, I personally think that only the worst of the worst should be in prison. And because it's become a corporate thing, a lot of these counties and towns have made deals with the corporate prisons, saying that you have to keep, if we're going to deal with your prisoners, you have to keep a 95% rate of incarceration. If you don't, if we have empty beds, you got to pay us anyway. So it leaves the judges and stuff in the counties purposely keeping these privatized prisons full so that they don't have to pay for empty beds.
Right.
That should never be.
Right. Well, that's a lot for us to think about and to work on. I mean, I'm going to post this and, let's see what dialogue we can
Okay,
have.
Randy has to do station identification.
Yeah, and then we'll have Pot Talk with Joe
Pot Talk, yeah.
Okay, so this is the Woodstock Community Network. You're watching Woodstock Public Access TV, Channel 3, which is 23, which is rebroadcasting WIOF-LP Woodstock 104. It is 11 o'clock in Woodstock, and now it's time for Pot Talk with Joe Barton.
I'm growing marijuana in my yard. I'm
Hey, while Joe's out for a cigarette, I'm going to kick off the show. A few weeks ago in the Woodstock Times, I'm not sure if it was Hugh Reynolds or another one of the excellent writers that they have, but he said that some uncle of his was a cop in New York City. He died at only 39 years old. But he talked about how he would, how a man would drink at a bar and probably drink up all his pay and be fearful to go back home to his wife and his children because he didn't have any money because he drank it all up, and he was getting abusive in the bar. So the bartender would call the cops to arrest him. And so this exemplary cop would come out and he would assess the situation, and he said, "You took the man's money, you take the man's abuse." And he wouldn't arrest him. He felt it was the responsibility of the bar who took the money to show some more responsibility about what they're doing. And he likened this to Hein taking campaign financing, because he said that it's something you can, you know, it's publicly disclosed, that Michael Hein took a contribution of $12,500 from somebody, and ostensibly for marijuana production, or to get a license, or somehow to be in good graces with the county. Well, now here we have the new marijuana law saying that licenses are available, and I think, what, about 50 people have applied, and it's a $10,000 non-refundable price to... Oh, thanks. To apply for a license, and that the license is going to be $200,000. So this is something that Joe has been predicting for a long time, because I think when I looked at your charges in 2008, when they came in without a warrant with all your plants, the charges said growing marijuana without a license, and at that time in 2008
you couldn't get a license. And unless you got $200,000. But what's really wild about it is how many people have gone to jail for selling marijuana, and the government said, oh, it's evil, just like they did with numbers. Back in the days when the mafia used to run numbers, where they said, oh, these criminals, they're taking people's money, and husbands are spending money instead of buying food for their kids, and it's immoral. And then they put all the mafia in jail. And then what did the government do? It opened lottery, which is numbers, basically. Or, you know, and it's the same thing. We've been putting people and incarcerating people and incarcerating people for selling marijuana. And yet now our government, who said it was evil and these people were a drain on society, now our government is selling it or allowing their cronies or people with big money to sell it. I'm totally against this. I think it should be free for everyone. Anyone should be able to grow it. And if a farmer grows tomatoes, he now can sell his tomatoes. Why shouldn't anyone be able to sell their marijuana? You know, now there's no tax on food and there's no tax on medicine. If marijuana is used as a medicine, there should be no tax on it, you know. And if you look at how they've regulated supposedly medical marijuana, you can get all kinds of poisons from the pharmaceutical companies. A doctor can prescribe it, and you can just go in the pharmacy and get it, and there's no problem. But if you wanted to use marijuana as a medicine, which... is definitely proven to be less harmful than, in fact, there's no harm from it, than all the pharmaceutical drugs, which will rot your liver or cause all kinds of problems, has many side effects, yet there's no problem with getting those drugs. But for marijuana, you got to jump through every kind of hoop. Doctors can lose their... if a doctor prescribes it and the government decides, well, he shouldn't have prescribed marijuana because he didn't try all these other drugs first, the doctor could lose his license. And the person, in a lot of these medical states, in order to be able to get a license for medical marijuana, you have to, the states where they allow you to grow it, to grow your own, you now, to have a license, you now have to allow the government at any time to come in your house and inspect, which means that the government can come in at any time and inspect your house to make sure that you're not growing an extra plant or an extra couple plants, which is outrageous. That they don't do that for any other medicine, yet there's all these extra restrictions on marijuana as a medicine. It's absurd. It's criminal on the part of the politicians. They know what they're doing. They've known that marijuana was a medicine before they made it illegal. It was in 50% of the pharmaceuticals in this country before it was made illegal. And then the DEA comes along and says has no medical value, when our government has patents on medical marijuana. Our government for many years actually supplied medical marijuana to very few patients, but it was very hard to get on that list. But now the laws that they have here that Cuomo passed are the worst marijuana laws, medical marijuana laws in the whole country. Not that I believe any of them are good. All of them are much too harsh. Anyone should be allowed to grow marijuana. I personally want to grow marijuana. For myself, it's a spiritual substance. I've always believed that. I've said that since the first time I was arrested back in 1972. For me, it puts me more in touch with my soul, and your soul is your connection to God. So therefore, anything that puts you more in touch with your soul puts you more closer to God. So that's what my argument has been on many of my court cases. And I want to be able to use it for spiritual reasons, which Cuomo won't even touch. I think that and even for recreational use, it has been proven that there is no harm from marijuana, yet alcohol has been proven to be harmful. You drink too much alcohol, it can cause death. No one has ever died from an overdose of marijuana. They've been very uncomfortable. I mean, you know, there's been times where I've eaten a little too much marijuana and it's very uncomfortable. But you know that when you finally come down, you're going to be okay. You might get a little paranoid. Oh, I'm too high. But other than that, it won't harm you. And it's been proven. All you people out there, well, again, I recommend go watch Run from the Cure, Rick Simpson. And you'll see that Rick Simpson has cured many, many people of cancer and many other diseases. Our government has done the research. They know. Back in 1974, there was the Virginia College research study that was funded by the DEA and who else?
The American
Cancer Society. And they proved that they found that marijuana attacked brain cancer cells. And in the study, they found that it attacked the brain cancer cells because it went through the blood-brain barrier, and yet it did not do any harm to the healthy cells. But when they tried to bury that report, they buried it for a while, and they didn't want anybody to even know about it, that it was actually beneficial. And then finally they came out and they said, we now have proof that marijuana attacks brain cells, which was a lie. They actually didn't tell people that the marijuana attacked the cancerous brain cells, but did no harm to the healthy cells. So our government has known that the truth about marijuana from the beginning, from when they first made it illegal. They knew what they were doing. Now we got Cuomo making this bogus medical marijuana law. And he did that because the legislature was ready to make a much more liberal law. Gottfried, what was he? Senator Gottfried, I think he was.
Oh, yeah.
Was trying to pass a law where people could grow their own medicine. And it was getting close to
it
being...
It was in 74, wasn't it? 72?
Well, no, that was when they decriminalized 2 ounces of marijuana.
Because Gottfried's still around.
Yeah. But he was pushing to get a much, much, much more liberal marijuana laws, which I still, he wasn't going far enough. But Cuomo came along, and he knew that the legislature was going to pass a law that where people would be able to grow their own. So to circumvent that, he came up with this bogus medical marijuana law. And you people out there in television land, too many of our children, our young kids are going to jail for this. It needs to stop. And unless you speak up and do something about it, the politicians, it's time to tell them, look, we're not going to vote for you if you keep on this stand, if you don't stop the incarcerations. Children have been taken away from parents because parents smoke a joint. And it's proven that, you know, someone who smokes a joint is not going to go out and commit murder or blow up some buildings, or, you know, it doesn't make people crazy like the reform.
Gateway drug.
Right, and it's not a gateway drug. That's been proven. For many years, that was the big scare campaign of the politicians. Oh, it's a gateway drug. If your kids smoke pot, they're going to move on to heroin. Well, that's been proven that that's not a fact, because many, many people have smoked marijuana and not moved on to harder drugs.
Gateway to the munchies, right?
Yeah.
Just say no. That's what all that gateway was. That was all part of the just say no and Nancy Reagan's war on drugs.
Right. And if the truth be known, the CIA and military intelligence was... they took over the drug trade. They put the mafia in jail who was dealing drugs, and then the CIA and military intelligence. Very few people understand most of the Vietnam War was not about communist aggression. It was about controlling the opium trade. If you read that, there's a book, The Politics of Heroin in Southeast Asia. I would recommend everyone read that book. They were bringing back opium and heroin in body bags. They were putting it in with GIs, and some body bags had no GI in it, and they were bringing it back. And then they started bringing Ollie North and Poindexter, and those guys were smuggling from Vietnam. And then later, the CIA was, during the Contra thing, was smuggling cocaine from South America. And they were even shutting down the radar for the United States so that they could come in with these planes and not be spotted, which was putting the whole country. At that time, we were afraid that maybe the Russians might nuke us. If the Russians had known that Ollie North was bringing in a load of cocaine and was going to turn the radar down, that would have been a prime time for them to launch a missile attack. So these guys, you know, they're not watching out for the best interests of the people. They're the ones bringing it in. And the big-time guys are bringing it in. You never see them go to jail. And then they dump it in the ghettos where poor kids, there's no... what causes the biggest cause of crime in the United States is poverty. You know, poor people are going to do what they have to do to get by, to make a living. And when the kids in the ghetto see you can only get $5 an hour at working for McDonald's, and the guy on the corner with gold jewelry all over him, driving a big Cadillac, selling cocaine. That's an incentive for these young kids to say, well, you know, I could deal some drugs and I could make some money, when instead of slaving at McDonald's for $5 an hour. And then when these poor kids in the ghetto start doing that, all of a sudden the government comes down on them with the full weight of the law, and they're given excessive sentences, and it's time for this drug war to stop. If our government is dealing drugs, how can they put citizens in jail for the same thing? It's absurd, and it's time for the American people to wake up and demand it to be stopped. Did you want to read more?
Yeah, I just wanted to read this article about campaign cash. Ulster County Legislature Chairman John Peretti recently released think piece on campaign finance reform may read like a resolution, but according to the author, it is at this point just a collection of ideas. That's just as well. Any piece of legislation that limits the county executive's ability to raise campaign funds will die a lonely death in committee sometime after the November election. Peretti's proposal, distributed to legislatures and the media at the end of last week's regular legislative session, would sharply curtail, if not eliminate entirely, donations to elected officials from vendors, consultants, and others doing business with the county. It would also make any donations by county workers to office holders under their direct control, including Parentes, illegal. I neither solicit nor accept campaign donations from my legislative staff, Peretti said. People